Do you ever hear voices in your head? Because there are plenty of Australians that have those voices that they can't quite shake. Hey there, I'm Marc Fennell, and tonight on Insight, where do those voices come from and what is it really like to live with them?
He had a deep voice. My first thought was, is this God speaking to me?
There was concern that people that hear voices end up locked away and are forced to get rid of them. And for me, I didn't want my voices to go. So that was a scarier thought.
Not everyone who hears voices will have a psychotic illness.
You never ever tell a voice hearer not to listen to their voices. That's the worst thing you can say to a voice hearer.
What is it like as a mum to watch your daughter go through this?
I've tried to put myself in Vanessa's shoes, but I can't feel that, and it's very hard for me to understand how difficult that must be.
Thank you all so much for joining us. I know this is a very personal, sensitive issue, and it's a huge thing for you guys to come and share this. Vanessa, I understand you started hearing voices way back in primary school, is that right?
As far as I can remember, I've always heard them, but specifically remember hearing them in primary school in about grade five.
Right, and what did you think they were? Because, I mean, it's quite young to be encountering that.
Yeah, I think at the time people often say, you know, the little voice in the back of your head, and I took that quite literally, that everybody was hearing the voices that I was hearing. So it wasn't until I got a bit older that I realised my voices or my perception of that was very different to everybody else's.
And what sort of things in those early days would they say to you?
So I have two sets of voices that I hear. In the early days, I think it was just one in particular, which was a group of voices that talk, and they would discuss me and talk about things that I was doing or the way I looked or my actions and really putting a sense of doubt in me about what I was doing. And then later on, the second voice came in, and that's a louder male voice.
And how different was the louder male voice in terms of what he was saying compared to, I guess, this panel of voices?
He was quite different in that he was very encouraging in a way and not in a positive way, though. So when I was having suicidal thoughts, he would be quite encouraging and telling me that that was okay, that I could go through with that.
And so as you got older, you get a job, like how does it start to impact life as you become an adult?
So it definitely became more prominent when I was stressed. So as I got older and was working in the corporate world, you know, work stresses came along and that's when the voice would be a lot louder and would take over more. So that made it a lot harder then.
Are there coping strategies that you sort of worked out you could use when you started hearing stuff?
Yeah, the main one that I use is listening to music. So even now I don't hear the voices any longer, but I still have that habit of having to put my headphones in and have music on all the time, almost to make sure that they don't come back.
This might seem like a strange question, but what kind of music helps block out the voices?
Pretty heavy, hardcore music.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
There you go. You learn something every day. Did you ever tell anybody?
Not until I was much older. I was diagnosed with bipolar and shortly after that I disclosed to my mum and doctors that I was hearing some voices, but even then I wasn't very forthcoming in what they were like or how prominent they were.
So in your life, there was a certain point you moved to Perth for work.
Yes.
And things took a pretty bad turn there. Can you explain what happened?
So I'd been there for I think about a year and a half. And work was just getting busier and busier. I was throwing myself into it as well. I was really enjoying it. I didn't really have any solid supports in Perth, so that made it hard. So, it just all came to a head one day on the way to work that I decided I was done and didn't want to be here anymore. Obviously, that didn't work out, which I'm grateful for now.
Yep.
And shortly after that, I think a week later, I came back to Sydney. And shortly after getting back to Sydney, maybe a few weeks later, I was hospitalised for the first time, and that's when my family found out about, how unwell I'd been.
So, Lynn, you're Vanessa's mum.
Yes.
You ended up taking 6 months off work to look after Vanessa?
We alternated, yes. I didn't work full-time, so we would be on 24-hour watch, and it was like that. At the time, we knew Vanessa would not be compliant staying in a mental health unit, and that's why we knew we needed to be there for her.
There's a practical component to this and then there's an emotional component to this. Mm. What is it like as a mum to watch your daughter go through this?
Of course, it's very difficult, but I would say with the diagnosis of bipolar, the depression, the anxiety, the suicidal thoughts, the suicidal ideation, the suicidal attempts, the hardest thing is the hearing voices, to understand that. And I've tried to put myself in Vanessa's shoes, and we have another child who has initially been diagnosed bipolar, and she also has the same types of experiences with the voices, but I can't feel that, and it's very hard for me to understand how difficult that must be. Mm. So I find that the hardest part of this whole journey.
Mm. Now, Sam, about 6 years ago, you were 18 years old, and as I understand it, that's when you first started hearing voices. For somebody that's never heard voices before, can you describe what it was you were hearing?
Well, when I first heard my first voice, I didn't have any clue of what it was like. It was completely new. My first thought was, is this God speaking to me?
Can I ask what it sounded like?
So it sounded like an older man, maybe in the 40s. He had a deep voice and he would constantly critique me. He knew all my thoughts, so he would focus on my insecurities and he would just say derogatory sentences day in, day out.
In your mind, was it audible? Did you think other people could hear it as well?
So at first I thought other people would hear it, and when I was around other people, I tested that. But after a while, I knew it was something only I could hear.
Mm. So I think it's important for people to understand that this voice is linked to a pretty crucial and pretty traumatic moment in your life. Can I ask what was happening that, I guess, triggered it or catalysed it?
So I was living on the Gold Coast with one of my good friends and a few of his friends. And he was at a party and he got stabbed at a party and he was in hospital for a few weeks. But unfortunately he passed away shortly after that. And about a week and a half, 2 weeks after that, that's when my voice started.
To the extent that you're happy to share, what sort of things was the voice saying to you?
It was making me feel really guilty. It said that I didn't spend enough time with my friend. I should have been around. I could have done something. And at that time, it was incredibly distressing hearing that.
Mm. So, as I understand it, about 2 weeks after that, you got another voice. Is that right?
That's right. And so 2 weeks after, I had a second voice, and they used to talk to each other.
Did you ever talk back to the voices?
I did. I tried fighting them a lot of times. But every time I'd try and fight them, they'd get louder, they'd be there longer. They'd really focus on the qualities that I wanted to improve.
Alita, you're Sam's mum. How much of this did you realise was going on when it was happening?
I don't think I realised at first. I noticed that he was starting to not be as sociable. He seemed quite sad. I noticed him crying sometimes, and I noticed he wasn't sleeping very well.
Right. And when you realised the extent of what was going on with Sam, what went through your head?
Well, my husband had developed voices about 6 years before, and so I was kind of like, oh, OK. I just kind of accepted it.
Mm.
But I was worried about it.
Naturally. When was the moment you decided that it was time to seek professional help for Sam?
I knew Sam was very distressed and he had disclosed that he was feeling suicidal, and I made him promise that he would talk to me before he did anything if ever things became too overwhelming. And one night he just opened the door, stood in the doorway, and he said, "Mum," and I realised that something was happening, so I jumped out of bed, took him in his room, and he just collapsed and he was just distraught, and he kept repeating, "The promise is done, the promise is done, I need to kill myself."
Sam, again, only to the extent that you feel comfortable sharing, what was your experience of that moment that your mum just described?
I almost couldn't hear her. The voices were so loud and so constant. It was all I could think about. I could barely sleep. And I felt like it was too much for me.
Okay. We are going to come back to you guys, but I want to bring in other people with this experience. Now, Katie, You had given birth to your second child. How quickly after that did you start to hear voices?
So it was around when she was 6 weeks old.
Wow, and you'd never heard voices before?
No, I'd never heard voices before. It was, yeah, just a bizarre experience for me.
Yeah. If you feel comfortable, do you mind explaining for people that have no frame of reference what that voice sounded like?
So it sounded like Gollum of Lord of the Rings. And he kept saying, she's precious, and he was instructing me to harm her.
And as you would hear these voices, what sort of feelings would, I guess, flow through you?
The biggest feeling I felt was shame. Because as a mother, it's your job to protect your child. And I didn't understand at the time that it was an illness, a condition. So I saw it as a flaw or as a weakness as such.
I mean, having a newborn child, I think, we know, is stressful enough to begin with. How were you managing these voices? Were you telling other people about them?
No, I didn't tell my health professionals at the time because I was scared that they would take my children away from me. So I basically buried myself in my garden and that's how I managed the voices for a period of time.
Right, and so in the end, you did tell someone, you told your partner, I understand. How did that conversation go?
I remember telling my partner and he basically told me to tell the voices to go away. So we were both really uneducated and just didn't really know what to do. So we were just kind of going into it blind, really.
Mm. And what did you think was going on?
So we would later find out that I would have diagnosed with bipolar. Initially, I was diagnosed with a postnatal psychosis.
When you heard that diagnosis, did it make it easier to start to process because it could be identified?
No, I felt like a failure, to be honest. I didn't feel any relief or anything.
Why a failure?
I guess because I had a lot of self-stigma. And there is still stigma in society as well around mental health conditions, particularly with hearing voices.
We're also joined by Georgie in Perth. Now, Georgie, you're a clinical psychologist. You've got a PhD in hearing voices. How many people do hear voices at some point in their life?
So large population studies have actually found that 10 to 25% of our population will hear voices at some stage in their lives. But that's a lifetime prevalence, the chance of you or I hearing voices in our lifetime. So if we took a random sample from our community, the percentage of people that would hear voices currently is more around 6 to 8%. So it's actually a lot more common than you'd realise.
Yeah, it is. So the technical term for this is auditory hallucination. And what I take from that is that it can be more than voices, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So we often talk about hearing voices, hence the title of this today, because it's the most common type of auditory hallucination. But people do actually hear other sounds. So they could hear cars or sounds of birds and animals, music like the radio or television. But we can also have hallucinations in other modalities as well. So people can see visions, people can have gustatory, so tastes that are not there, olfactory smells, and tactile as well, so sense things on their skin.
Georgie, already talking to people, it seems like there's a range of circumstances leading up to people hearing voices. Do we know why people hear voices?
Some of them are to do with biology. So we know that if people have a relative with who hear voices themselves or have a mental health condition that may be related to voice hearing, that the chances of hearing voices yourself are higher. But there are many other vulnerability factors, often of which occur during childhood, the strongest of which is childhood adversity or trauma. About 80%, and in fact a little bit higher than that, have trauma in their background, the strongest link being to childhood sexual abuse. However, not everybody does have trauma in their background, so it's not uniform in that way, and there are other vulnerability factors. Some people start hearing voices during their childhood, while other people won't hear voices till later in their life. And often that will be triggered at a time of a stressor. So we've heard a few today, but it can be grief, it can be other stresses that are happening in someone's life that actually kind of trigger off or have the onset.
Interesting. All right, Julia, you're a psychiatrist. I have a challenge for you. I want you to take me inside the brain. What is actually happening inside the brain when somebody hears voices?
When someone hears a voice, the areas of activity in the brain, and we know this from looking at the brain with what's called functional brain scanning, the area of the brain that is normally active when we all hear things is active, just as if you were speaking and you were hearing a real voice.
When did you find out what was triggering the voices?
It was actually a GP who picked it up, and she picked up the narcolepsy because she turned around to ask me a question as I fell off the chair, and she just looked at me and said, "What was that?"
Sam, when we last spoke to you, your mum had decided that it was time to seek professional help. Can I ask, how bad did it get for you that time?
For someone that's never been on a mental health ward, it was very distressing. There was a lot of loud noises, sort of traumatic experiences, especially for a young 18-year-old that I didn't understand for a while.
When did you get a diagnosis?
It was about 6 weeks after I was first admitted.
And what was the diagnosis?
Schizophrenia.
When you heard that diagnosis, what went through your mind? What were your thoughts?
I was actually quite relieved when I received that diagnosis because it had something physical that I could research, that I could look up and try and work towards sort of dealing with that. I found it very hard not knowing what was going on.
Mm. Vanessa, you saw psychologists, psychiatrists, and for quite a long period of time, you didn't tell them about the voices.
Yeah.
Why was that?
I think my concern was that if I explained fully or gave everything away, I would be diagnosed, and then I thought that would lead it to a point where it would be easier for them to lock me away.
So what was the moment when you decided you had to start talking about it to them?
I think it's when I started talking back to the male voice. I didn't realise I was doing it. I didn't realise I was saying it out loud. And when I was told that I was, it really hit home that it was overtaking my life.
Hmm. Eventually you were given a diagnosis of bipolar. I'm curious how you reacted to that diagnosis. Did it help to be able to kind of identify it?
My original diagnosis was depression, and then it was anxiety, and then it was bipolar 2, then bipolar 1, and now I think they've tacked on OCD as well. So for me, I've never found it to be a positive thing to be diagnosed because I felt like it just opened the floodgates. And my first psychiatrist was absolutely wonderful, and his approach to it worked for me where he didn't feel there needed to be a strict diagnosis. He was happy to just work with whatever the symptoms were. Let's deal with everything until you're at a point where you can live a comfortable and happy life. And that was the exact response I needed.
Mm. Vibha, can you tell me what was going on when you first started hearing voices for you?
When I was hearing voices, I was working as a social worker in Liverpool, and my family was overseas. I was living with my flatmate, and I could feel my concentration slowly deteriorating as I was working. The work environment was stressful. It was also very competitive. And the first time I'd been alone without my family, and I woke up one day and I suddenly could hear voices. And I could see, I had visions as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I could see black and white figures as well as round planet-like objects.
And what did you think they were?
I wasn't sure. I thought I was seeing parts of the universe, actually, and I thought that I was going crazy. I thought there was And I just talked about it to my flatmate, who told me not to go to a psychiatrist. And also, another thing what happened was that I felt as if the boundaries between me and the next person were blurred. Mm. So I felt as if they could sense everything about me. So I didn't go out of the house for a few days. And that's when I realised I had to go see a psychiatrist who diagnosed me with a mental health condition.
You mentioned work was competitive. You're also doing a master's degree at the same time.
I did my master's degree after I was diagnosed.
Right.
And I was on homeopathic drops as well as on medication. So I was hearing voices when I was doing my master's degree.
Right.
In between that, I went back to India and used methods there, cultural methods there that actually helped me with the voices.
What sort of impact do you think hearing voices had on your workload at the time?
I lost my focus and I couldn't basically work because I couldn't read, I couldn't use the computers, I couldn't do any of that sort of stuff, yeah.
It sounds like it would be quite hard to get things done, I imagine.
It's very difficult, it's very challenging to get things done because you're constantly being distracted by something else. I come from Indian culture. Mm-hmm. So they believe in the spiritual world, believe in spirits. So I call it I've been distracted by the spiritual world, by spirits, yeah. Hmm.
Was there anybody that you felt comfortable sharing what you were going through with?
I told my sister and my mother. Mm-hmm. And my sister told me not to tell anybody else because people would think I was crazy. And my mother said we'd go on this journey together to try and find answers to what I was going through.
Julia, quite a few people have mentioned that they didn't share. They were afraid of the stigma, they were afraid of the impact. Does that ever exacerbate the problem?
I think it could certainly delay people getting help that might have been useful to them at an earlier stage. I think it's also very understandable. I mean, these experiences are terribly frightening. It doesn't always mean that you're going to end up having a mental illness. Even if you do end up having a clinical diagnosis, there are many types of help that are available. And it is really interesting, the idea that people have the fear that if they share their experiences, that they might get locked away in a mental health hospital, which really isn't at all the case. But mm-hmm. It's important that we help people understand that. Sharing it with other people who you trust and also sharing it with a trusted health professional and seeking help early is a good path to take.
Vipa, would you agree with that? Does that ring true for your experiences?
Yes, I would definitely agree with that because I think if I hadn't talked about it to anybody else, it would have been a lot more frightening and I would be unable to actually live in the world the way I wanted to live.
Julia, we know that hearing voices is a symptom in some cases of psychosis, but I think it might be worthwhile to explore exactly what is psychosis for people watching. So do you mind breaking that down for me?
Sure. So psychosis is an umbrella term that we use to describe a group of conditions in which people have unusual experiences that are not in keeping with other people's experiences. So they're not necessarily at their most extreme in touch with reality. And the types of experiences can be hallucinations, as we've talked about, and hearing voices is one type of those. Then people can also have what we call delusions, which are very fixed beliefs which are held despite evidence to the contrary, that people become very focused by and their behaviours change because they believe so very strongly that these beliefs are true. And other things that can happen under this umbrella term of psychosis are difficulties with concentration, cognition, so thinking and memory. And the other key factor that's really important is that these are very distressing and troublesome experiences. For some people, hearing voices isn't so troubling. Some people find their voices sort of benign or even positive. We wouldn't necessarily call that an illness. So when we're talking about illness, we're talking more about these experiences when they become distressing and lead to poor outcomes in people's lives.
So when somebody presents as having the symptoms of hearing voices, does that always lead to a diagnosis of psychotic illness, or is it not that simple?
No, it's more complicated than that. It's true that many people who have psychosis hear voices, but not everyone who hears voices will have a psychotic illness.
I'd like to bring in Hannah here. Now, Hannah, your story is quite distinctive from everyone else's here because you went to see a GP, you talked about it, and that GP suggested schizophrenia. Mm-hmm. What was your reaction when you heard that?
Yeah, so I guess my experience of trying to get help when I, after I'd been hearing voices and seeing odd things and having tactile hallucinations on and off for many years, things came to a head after I developed quite intense symptoms over a week. And it was the experience of starting to hear voices coming out through the radio and becoming quite paranoid that led me to go to sort of try to talk through these experiences and try and get some sense of what they meant, because I still had this, I guess, residual degree of insight that these were odd. But I went to the GP and after a 15-minute consultation was told that I might have schizophrenia, but to just take some antidepressants and see how that was, and no follow-up appointment or anything. And so I left feeling extremely confused because, I mean, at the time I work in mental health now. I'm training to be a psychiatrist. But at the time I was a law student and had a very limited understanding of mental health, and particularly schizophrenia. So I avoided going back for any kind of help or support for a very long time. So I continued to live with my symptoms.
Just with that initial diagnosis of schizophrenia, like, did you instantly decide that it didn't apply to you? I'm still trying to understand how you reacted to that.
Yeah, so I didn't feel like it applied to me. I didn't feel like it fit my experiences or my symptoms.
And so if not schizophrenia, when did you find out what was triggering the voices?
The condition I have is called narcolepsy with cataplexy, which is a sleeping disorder. So I often have, you know, extreme bouts of or sudden onset sleepiness or fatigue, and sometimes I lose muscle tone. That's the cataplexy part. But the way they were finally diagnosed was actually when I was doing my GP rotation as a medical student. It was actually a GP who picked it up, and she picked up the narcolepsy because she turned around to ask me a question as I had a cataplectic episode and fell off the chair, and she just looked at me and said, "What was that?" And I was very, very embarrassed and apologetic and, you know, felt a lot of shame, as I often do when I have symptoms in front of people. And I said, you know, I've had these for a long time. They're really embarrassing. I can't control them. And she just said, well, you have narcolepsy and I'm writing you a referral to a sleep specialist, which confirmed the diagnosis. And then I was, started on medication.
And so how did the voices interact with the narcolepsy and the cataplexy? How do they work with each other?
Sometimes I'll see and hear things before I have an episode, or sometimes if I am having an episode and I, through sheer will, kind of push through the fatigue or the cataplexy, then I tend to have quite intense hallucinations for a time after that. And sometimes they sort of arise out of nothing and can be quite sort of fun and enjoyable.
That process of being misdiagnosed, what sort of impact do you think it had on you, how you felt about what you were going through?
Looking back, it was a very disappointing experience that left me terrified and, you know, without appropriate help and support. So if I was to give myself some advice as the patient back then, I think it would have been to go and see a different practitioner, go and see a different GP, or to follow through with psychology, or, you know, just to kind of keep pushing. But I was so fearful that there was something wrong with me that I avoided any kind of follow-up. I found it preferable to live with the symptoms rather than to admit there could be something wrong.
Georgie, to flip the point of view around here, from, I guess, the point of view of a health professional, How easy is it to identify the sources of hearing voices when somebody presents?
Look, sometimes it's really quite clear-cut. So really when we're talking about those vulnerabilities I was talking about earlier, we can really trace things, some biological sources, some sources of kind of adversity in their childhood. Also, sometimes in adulthood there might be clear triggers. There also might actually, like Hannah, we might actually know of a neurological condition or a health condition. So there's more of an organic cause for hearing voices. But sometimes we can't identify that. And in terms of progressing with therapy, it's not a big hurdle. The types of therapies that we offer really focus on the person's experience and how they're managing that, and go from there. So really the diagnosis itself is slightly less important in terms of psychological therapy, or the causes behind that.
So what Hannah described earlier was a doctor who, I guess, jumped to schizophrenia, which is a psychotic illness. Do you think it's possible that doctors jump to diagnosing psychotic illnesses perhaps a bit too soon?
Look, unfortunately, that can be the case. I'd still really encourage people to go forth if they are experiencing these. Like Julie said, if we get in early, people respond much better to both psychological therapies but also to medications if that's what's recommended. So I still recommend people go in. But like with Hannah, if they get somebody that doesn't really understand them, and they don't feel gels with them, to move on to somebody else. People are much better mental health trained, including general practitioners these days. So I would say that that's happening less and less.
Julia?
Look, I agree with nearly everything that Georgie said. I think it was very unfortunate what happened to Hannah. And I think if we hope that a lot of the medical profession is much better educated in understanding unusual experiences and where they might lie on a spectrum of mental health difficulties these days. I hope it would be unusual nowadays for someone in a 15-minute consultation to diagnose someone with schizophrenia. And I would certainly second what Georgie said, that you can always go for a second opinion. If you're not happy with the response of the first doctor you see, you know, go see someone else, and perhaps go with someone that you trust and have someone advocate for you on your behalf.
Vanessa, when you did finally have a diagnosis, what were the sorts of things that you started doing with your psychologist, your psychiatrist, that started to help?
For me, it was a very long journey of years to get back to health and being able to maintain a average life. The main things were having good supports there, so having a good psychologist and psychiatrist that I gelled with and that understood me, having the support of my family, so my parents and sisters, my partner, really close friends that understood. I have a really good boss now who is very flexible, and good. That's allowed me to go back to work.
What about medication?
I've been on the same medication for maybe 3 years now, and that's been quite good, and about 2 months ago I started reducing one of my medications, so I'm now on a path to reducing them all, probably not to zero, but reducing them more, which will hopefully get rid of some of those side effects of them.
Mm. Sam, you're on antipsychotic medication too. How has it been working for you?
So I've been through a lot of different antipsychotics, but since I started on the current medication I'm on, I've been doing really well for about 2 years. And I've been doing so well that I've reduced some of my other medication as well, slowly though.
For you, is medication going to be a long-term thing?
Yes, yes.
Julia, in general terms, what are the sort of side effects that can come from antipsychotics?
Yeah. So, unfortunately, there are a lot of side effects associated with different types of antipsychotic medications. And the older drugs tended to cause quite a lot of quite distressing side effects, which affected people's muscles and ability to walk. The newer drugs, I'm going to say newer, these have been around for about 30 years, have those side effects less, but unfortunately can impact on people's metabolic outcomes quite badly. So we get increased levels of high blood sugar, increased metabolic syndrome, increased tendency to put on weight, which in itself can draw a lot of attention to someone.
Are there circumstances where antipsychotic drugs don't work?
In people who have a psychotic illness, the first line treatment is that they should have an antipsychotic medication. And alongside that, hopefully there may be availability made for them to also have psychological therapy. But the antipsychotic treatments will work for about 80% of people in their first episode. Unfortunately, about 20% of people won't respond, won't get better, even if they're taking the treatments. Unfortunately, there is a subset of people with psychotic illness who will continue to have symptoms even if they take medication. And therefore, the approach of treatment needs to be trying to help reduce the distress and trying to assist them to have coping strategies, supports around them to help them as much as possible have day-to-day function and quality of life.
Mm. Georgie, are there circumstances you've encountered where antipsychotics simply don't work?
Julie's talked a lot about people with psychosis, and as she's pointed out, for a lot of people it is a really important part of their recovery journey at different stages, and for a lot of them it is effective. Some of those people, though, it improves their kind of thought disorder and difficulties thinking, delusions, but may not actually help their voice hearing that much. But also 65% of people that hear voices actually don't have a psychotic illness, and for them antipsychotic medication are often not helpful.
I'd like to bring in Ash here, joining us in Perth. Now, Ash, you've heard voices for pretty much as long as you can remember, but at a certain point in your 20s, you went to Perth's Voices Clinic. So what was happening? What drove you in there in the first place?
I was seeking treatment for other mental health diagnoses that I'd been given, and I was doing a residential mental health recovery program here in Perth with a lot of encouragement from the people that worked in that program that was supporting me. I finally relented and went to see Georgie at Perth Voices Clinic because I guess I was at a point where I didn't know what else to do and I didn't understand them.
You walk into Perth Voices Clinic. How different was the reception you got there compared to what you were expecting?
What opposite end of the spectrum completely. My voices were quite vocal at the time. They are at the moment as well. And so there was a lot of resistance coming from them, which made the experience quite distressing because they didn't want me to be there. Mm-hmm. But as far as my experience from the clinician that I'd gone to see, which happened to be Georgie, it was amazing.
Okay. And what were the sorts of things that you did at Perth Voices Clinic that started to help?
I think it was a lot of conversation, which really helped me to understand their origin, I guess, and knowing that my fear of receiving the diagnosis of schizophrenia or psychosis, and you know, for me it was this feeling of, oh my gosh, I'm crazy. Mm. You know, it was a relief to know that that wasn't the case.
So ultimately, what was the diagnosis? What did you find out was causing the voices?
I've had many a diagnosis, never a diagnosis of psychosis or schizophrenia. And it's believed that I hear voices in the context of complex PTSD due to substantial and sustained childhood abuse.
And so for you, Ash, do medications play a role for you?
Currently, no. Over the years, I've been on a lot of medications. They were all to treat different symptoms of my other diagnosis, so depression, anxiety, complex PTSD and things like that. But, yeah, nothing to specifically treat the voices.
I might bring Georgie back into the conversation here. Georgie, can you walk me through what are the sorts of things, the treatments and processes you can do that don't involve drugs?
Absolutely. So at Perth Voices Clinic, we offer evidence-based psychological interventions, and we have three tiers or three different modes of therapy. So the first is cognitive behaviour therapy, or CBT, and this is a very common intervention for a lot of different mental health conditions. Now, for voice hearing, it means targeting triggers of voices or the things, the stresses in life that kind of make their voices worse. Then we also talk about coping, so what, how people respond to their voices, what works, what doesn't work, but also some strategies to help minimise distress and regulate their emotions around their voices. The next stream is more relating type approaches. This is where the individual works on improving the relationship they have with their voice, because for some people their voice is something they've heard for a very long time and they may well hear for the rest of their life for some individuals. So this is about restoring kind of the power balance in that relationship and allowing more assertive and compassionate communication. Now, the third type of intervention that we offer is a trauma-informed approach. So this is really working more on the cause of their voice hearing for individuals where trauma really has been at the heart of their voice hearing experience. So we'll work to kind of resolve some of those really distressing memories, which are intruding perhaps in PTSD symptoms, but also into the content of their voices and the distress they experience from their voices.
Mm. Vanessa, as you mentioned, you are on medication at the moment. Do you still hear voices?
No, I haven't since I started taking a new medication about 3.5 years ago.
What is it like to lose the voices?
Really hard.
Why hard?
Because they've just always been there. And like I said, with the male voice, especially in bad times, he was always there. Although he may not have been a good influence, yeah, he was always there. So it's been quite difficult to adjust to not having them.
Sam, do you still hear voices?
Yes, I've always heard voices. The medication hasn't stopped that, but it's reduced the volume a lot.
Is there any part of the cacophony of voices that you ever miss?
The voices, no.
Okay.
They've always been quite derogatory and they've been very hard to live with.
Mm. Katie, you're also on medication at the moment. What is the status of your voices?
So I currently don't hear voices. I haven't heard voices for 2 years. 2 years ago, they introduced a new medication, and since that, I have not heard any voices.
Mm. It is worth pointing out that you have a few other strategies that you've employed as well. Have a look.
I try to exercise around 4 to 5 times a week. It mainly consists of swimming. There is some gym work in there as well. Sometimes it might be just a walk. Exercise makes me feel good. It makes me feel happy. It helps to manage my thought patterns. I've always been attracted to the water. It's just a place where I feel safe. I like the feel of the water on my skin. Focusing on your breathing, it brings you back to the present moment. I don't know if it's just that doing that really fast exercise and getting your heart rate up helps you to self-regulate. It's one of the things that my doctor suggested that I get back into.
She had to do lots of running. And then she just did starfish.
When I was put on lithium 2 years ago, I stopped hearing voices.
What do you got?
Flowers.
The medications give me good quality of life. I'm able to function and live a relatively normal life.
That's what I've been doing all day.
I currently work as an intentional peer worker. I share parts of my lived experience. The people that I'm working with also have a diagnosis. We're working together on their mental health. My work gives me a sense of purpose, and it also creates healing as well, because it kind of gives meaning to some of my own suffering. Hearing voices is not something that we generally discuss, so I think we need to create more awareness. I was ashamed of what other people would think of me, so that's why I didn't seek treatment. But the earlier you get in, particularly with hearing voices and psychosis, the better. What's really important to my mental well-being at the moment is I make sure that I take my medications, I try to exercise regularly, also talking about how I'm feeling rather than not telling people or not being honest, and spending time with my family and friends. And they're all really helpful things that I do to stay well.
Most voice hearers don't want to talk about their voice hearing experiences. And from my own experience as a carer and my family's experience as carers, we were like that. We pushed the voices away, we showed fear, and we shouldn't have done that.
The role of the carer can be a pretty complicated one. Bruce, your daughter Melissa started hearing voices after a particularly traumatic experience.
Correct.
When did you find out?
Well, we didn't find out till Mel was about 19, but she actually started hearing voices when she was 14 after a traumatic event. And she suppressed that, stuck it in a box, nailed it down, got on with the life, had a very successful academic situation through school. But another event when she was 18, a dear friend of hers took his life, and that changed the whole situation. The voices went to another level, and within 6 months she was gone from being the top of the tree, ducks of the school, to being a person in the system that was unable to cope with virtually anything in life.
And how was that for you as a parent, watching that unfold?
I was a carer, but my wife Faye and my two sons Adam and Tim, we were all a team of carers. Well, it was just devastating. Having seen your daughter do so well in academically, sporting things, we had no idea of the traumatic event, and we had no idea of the voices. So to see her in that situation was horrific.
Bruce, in 2008, you became aware of something called the Hearing Voices Movement, which I don't think a lot of people will be aware of. Can you just explain to me what it is?
Well, the goal is to support people with lived experience. It is to promote the running of self-help groups for people who hear voices. Overseas, these groups have been proven to be very, very successful. But also to promote a view that, that hearing voices is a very complex, significant and meaningful reaction to life events, which should be explored rather than a mental illness necessarily to be ignored.
I'm sorry to say that in 2010, your daughter Melissa did pass away.
She did.
Are there techniques that you wish you had known of when she was alive?
Yes, there is. I mean, obviously, I've been fortunate through the last 10 years. I've learned a lot about the hearing voices approach, a lot about how to work with people who hear voices. We set up a foundation for my daughter in 2012, and that's been operating now to provide support similar to the Hearing Voices Movement, Hearing Voices Network. But things that I've learnt, if I'd known what I know now, I would have taken my daughter, stuck her on a plane, and taken her to the UK, where they were 10, 15 years ahead of us in terms of the way that they their attitude towards that experience. But there was lots of people who had recovered from their voices and were using that experience to help people around the world learn how to work with their voices. So that would have been the thing that we would have done.
So you think being able to show her that there are people that had recovered would have made a difference?
Absolutely. One of the biggest problems that we found, and I mean no disrespect to the system, because Mel came across a lot of wonderful people in the system, but there was this underlying feeling of pervasive hopelessness that tend to engender itself through the system when a person goes through services. And Mel was, had a number of diagnoses. None of them were helpful to her because they didn't really do anything to provide a strategy to help her move forward.
If people watching this now that are carers of people that are hearing voices, what would you want them to know?
Well, first thing I'd advise would be to learn as much as you can about the experience, and there's a lot of information. As Georgie mentioned before, with voices, it's about changing your relationship with the experience. Most people tend to push the voices away because they're frightening and they're derogatory. But the reality is, for those that recover, they'll tell you that the only way you can do that is to embrace the voices and change that relationship with the voices. Learn how to communicate, learn how to set boundaries, learn how to work with them.
Your organisation also run workshops for health professionals. What are the sorts of things that you teach them?
We teach them about different ways to look at the voice hearing experience, that it is about changing the relationship. It is about voice hearers being able to reduce that level of fear. Most voice hearers don't want to talk about their voice hearing experiences. And historically, and from my own experience as a carer and my family's experience as carers, we were like that. We pushed the voices away, we showed fear, and we shouldn't have done that. You never ever tell a voice hearer not to listen to their voices. That's the worst thing you can say to a voice hearer. You might as well tell them to jump over the moon. And you must encourage them to talk about their voices and be in a situation where you can treat it like as a normal human experience. Bring it into the house. That will give them a stronger view of their experiences, and it will help them in working through their in a clinical environment when they're working with their voices.
Sam, how would you describe your relationship with your voices now?
It's a bit of a love-hate relationship. I love to hate them, but I understand that they're there and I try my best to live with them.
Vanessa, tonight you've shared a bunch of stuff that you've never really shared publicly before. I feel compelled to ask, how are you feeling?
Calm.
Calm. Good. Good. How does it feel to be able to share this stuff to, in effect, in front of a bunch of cameras, actually break that stigma?
Yeah, it actually feels very good. I think a big part of it is a lot of the time when I have told people, and that's very few people, they don't know how to react or what to say or do, and I understand that. But I think it's important for people to ask questions, not just be put off because you don't understand someone that is a bit different to you. So I hope that at the end of this, if you do know somebody that has a mental illness or psychosis or whatever it might be, that you can feel comfortable to ask them maybe one more question than you would have otherwise.
Well, to all of you, thank you so much for coming and sharing your very, very personal stories with us. That is all we have time for.